we have been discussing about resistance estimation using relations which have been evolved through experimental analysis carried out by different groups. We have already seen the methods put forward by Haltrop Menon, Van Utmarsen, Guldama Howald, and Savisky's method and all that. And also we have seen the resistance estimation carried out for a typical ship, that is an LPG carrier, and which has been analyzed using CFD method. And we have seen the comparison of the resistance results obtained using different methods against the experimental values and also the CFD results. And later we have discussed about the CFD analysis of a 1,000-ton barge, or it's an oil barge, using CFD for the estimation of resistance of the vessel. So this is the one which we have discussed in the previous class, which has shown the, which shows the water elevation, what is shown here, and which we discussed also about that the elevation of water is high at the forward side, it comes to about 1.76 meters. And so this results in higher wave resistance, and also you can see there is a change in the water elevation. You can see here is a trough formed and here is a crest formed. So the size of the wave is high, and hence the energy associated with that is going to be high, wave maker resistance will be high. So this, it is advisable to have a form change for this vessel, and this vessel is not having bulbous bow, so one can think of introducing a bulbous bow so as to reduce the resistance, the bow wave, and bring down the size of the bow wave and also the wave along the ship, which subsequently reduces the wave making resistance and also a possible wave breaking resistance. So now we look into another, some of other methods, resistance estimation methods. Again here they are based on the experimental data obtained for resistance, ship resistance, by performing model test. And this vessel, this method, what is a Taylor-Gerdler standard series, which came up in 54. And which has the models, the ships which have been tried for model test are the twin screw vessel. And twin screw vessels, you have, you can see that there may be a form variation in the aft of the vessel to accommodate the twin screw. So that affects, that contributes to the, or changes the resistance of the vessel. And so that is why the importance, why it is specified twin screw vessel. Then the type of stern used is the cruiser stern. You know that cruiser stern and I just explained how that stern differs here. The cruiser stern, if you consider, this is a type of stern. Which is called cruiser stern. This is a cruiser stern. Whereas when it comes to transom stern, you see there's another type. It will be like this. So this is the transom stern. So here, what the model is considered, because transom stern is relatively a new evolvement or evolution of the ship form in the aft, whereas cruiser stern used to be the conventional type. So here, this transom the ship what is used is a cruiser stern ship. Then he used a bulbous bow. So here ram bulbous bow. So the bulbous bow, the form goes like this. This is a type of bulb used. So here is a water line. So the bulb is of this type, So that means it's extended on a 4 foot. You can see here it's a 4 foot. The raised 4 foot. So 4 foot is this region. This is a region for 4 foot. So this region is not that. It is a raised 4 foot. So that is a type of shape considered for the vessels, based on which the model tests, models have been prepared and tests have been conducted for the estimation of resistance in a towing tank. Also, the midship section, it shows that it is, you consider the midship section, it's having a dead rise angle, it's a dead rise angle or riser floor. You can see that it goes like this, then it has got a large build radius. So that's the type of the midship section. So it has an angle. If you consider the base, got an angle here, and this is the bilge radius, and that radius is a large radius. That is what it is explained here. You can see here in this the midship section, a small dead rise and also relatively large bilge radius. Then the forwards, the section shape in the forward and aft. Usually, if you take a section shape here, the forward, if you take a section, it may be something like that. We take the forward section here. This is a bulb section, which come like this. This is a section of the. We take a section at the forward side, and this is U-shaped. This sections coming in the forward. So what you have is you have other sections coming like this. So you have the section shapes coming like this. This is the shape which it's going to possess. So this is of U shape in the forward side. This is U shape. So the here the V shape is slightly narrower in the bottom and upper. So here this is the water level, you can see. And whereas when it comes to the aft side, they have used a V section. So aft section may be so it just goes like this. So this is a type of section used for the shape, and the keel flat rising at the extreme stern. You can see here this is a keel flat rising at the extreme stern. So if you consider the keel, the bottom it may have a flat position. You can have a flat position, and this is going, and usually comes when it here. It goes like this. The keel rises up, and also the keel is rising at the end. So, this is the type of form of the vessel they have tried. So here you can see the breadth to draft ratio is 2.25 to 3.75 D by T ratio. That is the dimension ratio used for the vessel. Then the prismatic coefficient range from, it's a wide range, 0.48 to 0.86. V by L cube, this is a range 0.001 to 0.007, and Froude number 0.15 to 0.6. Sorry. So this is the vessel specification, and now you extend that, also reported by Fisher. You consider a B by T. Suppose the vessel B by T is greater than 3, in the above you can say that it is ranges from 2.25 to 3.75. So now it is putting a clause here. If B by T is greater than 3, then the residual resistance coefficient is given by this expression. It is CRB. You can see the B and T are used here. Volume displacement by L cube. These are the parameters used. And if B by T is less than 3, then you use this expression for the estimation of residual resistance. So you know that when you perform the model test, you have to meet the Froude. You can meet the Froude condition, and meeting the Reynolds number is not possible. So usually you prefer to run the model under the condition of Froude, the proposed by the Froude, that is where the model speed is equal to the ship speed divided by square root of the scale of the model, okay. So that is what you do. And so what you get, what you measure from the total resistance, you know the procedure, we have already discussed about that. From the procedure you get the total resistance, and that is, you find out what is the total resistance for the morphant of the model. Then you, from this you find out what is the for this condition you find out the residual resistance of the model equated by total resistance of the model minus frictional resistance of the model. So this you get from IDTC or any similar formula. So that is a procedure. Then you can non-dimensionalize this value RTM. So what you do is, which we have already discussed. So from here you get the coefficient, sorry, CRM is equal to R from here, residual resistance of the model divided by half rho of model, vector surface of the model into model losses. That is why you get CRM, and from this you will get CRM is equal to CRS, and from which you after this you find out what is the CF of ship, again using IDTC formula or any similar formula. And from, once you get CFS, you put along that CT of the ship is equal to CR of the ship plus CF of the ship, that is what you get, plus the allowances CA you put. So that is what you find out, the total resistance of the ship is equal to the residual resistance of the ship plus, which is same as CRS, you know that it is same as CRM. So you get this, and this value, and that is interesting, getting the CR here. So you get the CR, which is actually the same for the non-dimensional coefficient for residual resistance, same for ship and model, since you followed the fruit hypothesis of fruit condition for the model test. So here, depending on B by T, you decide which is appropriate, and then you choose the corresponding formula, and where CRB is a parameter, and here you know that CRB is given by this expression, and this expression got the parameter S suffix LX, because LX here, LX S square here and S cube here. So this parameter is given by this expression, which is in terms of root number and prismatic coefficient. So you know the speed of the vessel, and you know the speed of the hence the root number for that condition, and you know the prismatic coefficient of the vessel. So you get this value, so you get SLX. Once you get SLX, you get into this formula here and substitute it here, you get CRB. Once you get CRB, get over to the corresponding formula, appropriate formula which you use depending on B by T, then you get, you know all these quantities, so you find out what is the CR. Once you get CR, next component which you look forward is the estimation of the frictional resistance coefficient. So frictional resistance coefficient, here what they suggest is use the Schoner skin friction line, which we have discussed when we discuss about the frictional resistance. We have discussed about Schoner formula, Hooke's formula and IDTC formula. So here you use the Schoner formula for the estimation of CF. So once you get the frictional resistance coefficient, so then you can find out the CR plus CF, that is equal to the total resistance coefficient for the model, and when you, then I have already explained how to extrapolate it to the ship. Next method which is also widely used is a BSRA method, methodical series. BSRA stands for the British Ship Research Association. So they have done extensive experimental studies quite some time back. You can see 59, this is a time what they have done, and this is generally done for fulliform ships and like bulk carriers and tanker vessels. And if you are designing a bulk carrier tanker vessel, the form itself is available based on this series. And since the form is already available and it's also a proven form, you can use it, and for which the resistance data is provided in as an, you know, expression form. So based on that experimental data, a regression analysis is created and it is forwarded. It was created by Sabet 1971, and also you can see this reference by the book by Moland. So the resistance data, that is residual resistance coefficient, is a function of L by delta raised to 1/3 B by T, block coefficient, and position of center points, the longitudinal position of center points. So here CR is defined using this expression, R into L by mass displacement into P square. This is the expression. Usually we put CR is equal to R by half rho SV square, but here they use another, just, you know, expression for this non-dimensionalization. You can see here is a 400. So the suffix 400 denotes value of a 400 feet ship. So that is what is giving. Speed considered here is Vk by Lf. Vk means the speed in knots divided by Lf means length in feet. So that's what we have to put. So this ratio V by L, where V should be in knots and L should be in feet, that the ratios are given for so much 0.5 to 0.8 with an increment of 0.05. So the load or draft conditions consider a full load. So they have considered the vessel, tested the models for three loading conditions. One is when it's fully loaded, which means that the ship or model is floating at the design load water line. Then two other conditions, one is a medium condition or intermediate load condition, and other one it's a light condition. So they have already explained how they treat this. So the value of these quantities, that's the parameters coming here for ZR, depends on the load condition. It's obvious when the ship floats at different water line, it's going to have different resistance characteristic, and which in turn depends on these parameters, that is the L by delta power third, B by T, CB and LCB. So it is going to depend on that. So there will be a change when you consider CR value for different loading conditions. The CR what you get at full load condition, medium load condition and light load conditions are going to be different. They are not going to be same. So here the draft ratio, intermediate, the draft ratio TR is equal to intermediate draft or any draft which you measure or at that draft, draft at which the model test is performed, which is less than the design load water line or design draft, divided by the load draft, that is the maximum draft permissible for the vessel. So this ratio is called the draft ratio. For medium load, we have seen the conditions here, full load, medium load and all that, and light load. For medium load, the TR, which is the draft ratio, is taken as 0.808 of the maximum load of full load draft, and for light condition is taken as 0.616 times the load draft. So this is a way how they define the load, the draft conditions depending on the respective load condition. So displacement ratio, there is another term defining, delta R is equal to intermediate displacement by load displacement. So the vessel is now floating at a lower draft, so you have to identify what is the, or you have to estimate what is the displacement at that lower draft. That displacement divided by the displacement of the vessel when it's floating at the design load water line, that's called the displacement ratio given by delta R. So use these expressions to get delta and 1 delta at any intermediate draft. CB is the value at load displacement. So what you do is CB, you keep it at the load displacement. So here you consider CB. you consider CB for a range of 0.65 to 0.725, then the delta R is given by this expression. So you can find out delta R, that's the displacement ratio is equal to 1 plus TR. TR we have already seen is the draft ratio, and we have seen that the value TR is equal to 0.808 in the previous slide, I think 0.808 for into TL for medium load condition and 0.616 into TL for the light load condition. So you know this TR value from that, and also you know the CB of the vessel says a CB at the load displacement, it's not changing, and then you have put CB cube, so you find out what is the displacement ratio, that's the ratio of the displacement at the water line at which the model test has been carried, divided by the maximum displacement of the model or vessel. So here if that's a expression for CB, which if it falls within this range, if the CB fall within this range, that is 0.725 to 0.8, then the displacement ratio is given by this expression. So you can just, you know all these values here, CB and TR, substitute, you get the delta R value, displacement ratio. So you use the following expression to get LCB. Now the another thing what you need to know is LCB, because the LCB is a parameter inside to find out the CR value. So LCB again at any intermediate depth, intermediate draft, you consider again two expressions given for LCB, same CB between 0.65 and 0.725, the first case LCB is equal to LCB at load condition, LCB at load condition is known, so you find out LCB at load condition from the hydrostatics. So LCB at load condition, TR is known, CB is known, so you know CB, then this is known now, LCB load condition, so all these quantities are known, so you substitute the values here of the various quantities and then you get what is the LCB at an intermediate depth. So intermediate depth is determines the TR, that intermediate depth is reflected in TR, because TR is equal to the intermediate draft divided by the maximum draft, so that is reflected here. So that's how you get the LCB for the intermediate draft. If the block coefficient is falling in this range 0.725 to 0.8, then you have the LCB given by this expression. Only this data changes, which comes from a regression expression, the coefficients changing according to that. So you have the LCB, all the TR, CB, all these values are known, so you get LCB here. So depending on the vessel CB, you select which expression need to be used, and using that expression you get the LCB here. Now we have seen how to get TR, how to get delta R, how to get LCB for intermediate. So now you see full load condition. Now we have said this BSRA method is applied for three loading conditions, that is the full load condition, intermediate condition and light condition, isn't it? So first we consider the full load condition. Full load condition L by delta power 1/3 is given by you consider the range of application is 4.2 to 6.4. B by T range of application 2.2 to 4, CB 0.65 to 0.8, say 0.8 means the full form, this comes, then LCB minus 2% to 3.5%. So here the LCB position they are considered, the form of the ship changes. So the form of the ship, that is there is a concentration of volume of the form of the ship. So you can see that if the ship, if it's, we consider the form here, the ship is floating at this water line. Now if you consider maybe a water plane where you may get a shape like this, so such a shape, so depending on that, so if you consider this is the aft perpendicular, and here it is a forward perpendicular. So somewhere in the mid length you call it the midship. So the longitudinal position of the center of gravity is, or the center of, not center of gravity, the center of buoyancy. Center of buoyancy is the centroid of the underwater volume of the ship. So the depending on the fullness of the vessel to the forward or aft, the position of center of buoyancy changes. Suppose the ship is fuller in this region, forward side, if you take the fullness of the form, the center of buoyancy may be somewhere here if it is full. So LCB this side is taken as positive. So that means if you consider the range what we discussed, that is LCB from -2 to 3.5%, the +3.5% means it is LCB is, this distance is 3.5% means 3.5 divided by 100 of LBP. So it is 3.5% of LBP. So that is what it means. So if the ship is fuller towards aft, then LCB moves to the aft of midship, and if that is the case, this may be the B position. So here what is given is the maximum distance is 2% of LCB, 2% of length. So this is becomes 0.02 LBP. So that is what it means. So it is going to be, this side is negative, aft side is negative, and forward side is taken as positive. So why you define LCB in resistance is that determines the fullness of the form. If the LCB is forward, the body or the ship underwater form is more full in the forward side, and usually that offers more resistance for the ship. Because more full, that means you get more hydrodynamic, you know, flow variations, which leads to increase in resistance. So if the form is fuller in the aft and finer in the forward, the resistance usually decreases. So that is the importance of providing LCB, specifying LCB in the resistance estimation. So here this residual resistance coefficient, again 400 associated that 400 feet long. So it is given by Y400 into this. So what is Y400? It is given here. This is equal to A1 X1 plus A2 X2, then it goes up to A16 X16. So all this A1, A2, etc. are given in the reference which I have seen in that book by Molland. You can refer that. The values of A1 and A2, all these are given there. Whereas the X1, X2 are defined like this. X1 is equal to 1, X2 is equal to that L by delta power 1/3 minus, so this is the expression for that X2. X3 is given by this expression. All are known, B and T known, delta known, L. So all these quantities are known. So you can estimate this X1, X2. You can see that X4 depending on CB, X5 depending on LCB is known from hydrostatics. So X6, X2 square. So all these quantities are coming from the previous X values, and hence you will be able to estimate all the X quantities, X1 to X16, and also you know the coefficients which comes from the regression expression of the data. So then you find out Y, and then you find out, from once you know Y, you get ZR, and once you get CR, you can see, you can find out what is the resistance from this expression. So that is a procedure adopted in BSRI method. This regression expressions have been given by Sabit. You have seen that. Originally it was given in a chart when the tests were done in 50s. It was created as a chart, design chart. Later, for easier, to make it easy for computational job, so you need an expression. So carried out the regression analysis and came out with a regression expression, and this is a regression expression which has been evolved from that. So this is the expression which is given for a fully loaded condition. BSRI method of estimating resistance for the vessels coming under the range of applicability specified by them in the fully loaded condition. So that is the this one. Now you consider same, the medium load condition. the medium load condition, we have seen the three conditions. So this is the second condition, medium load condition. Ship may not, may be operating at a design for 100,000 tons DWT, and it may be operating at maybe 50,000, because depending on the load and all that. So there may be a variation. So you would like to know what is the resistance change due to the change in the loading condition. So medium load condition, here it says L by delta power 1/3, 4.6 to 6.9, that's the range. B by T 2.6 to 4.6, CB, this is the range. LCB, you can see this. So these parameters are differ now, and based on which, how do you get the residual resistance coefficient? So again, put another parameter here, Z, and then you find out Z is equal to B1 R1 B2 R2, same as what you have seen before A1X. Here it's a B1 R1. So you have the same up to 16. So you have 16 terms here. So again, R1, R2, all the parameters are explained here, all depending on the known parameters such as B, T, L, displacement, volume displacement, all LCB. So all these are known, CB. So everything is known. So you just substitute the values, you find out R1, R2, etc. up to R16, and the B1, B2 and R given in the references coefficient, which is obtained from the regression analysis. So once you get all these quantities, then you can find out what is the Z here, and then substitute here, you get CR value. So use that to find out the residual resistance coefficient of the vessel. So here the third loading condition, light load condition, we have already seen that the draft is 0.616 times the full load draft. So here you can see the range 5.1, you can see the previous ones, it is starting from 5.1, there is 4.6, there is 4.2. So there is a difference due to the displacement variation, because this denominator changes. So here you have these values, B by T given by this, and CB, this is a range. So when it comes towards the lower draft, naturally the CB also comes down, isn't it? It's more fine towards the bottom. So when they consider lower draft, light draft means the CB value will be less. So it's more fine towards the bottom. And also same thing, the breadth, also breadth and draft, if you compare, there will be a variation. The draft is coming down, so I think this ratio goes up. T is coming down, you can see that here is 3.4, here is 2.6, and here is 2.2. So that, which implies that the T value is going down for different loading condition, that's why the B by T range is changing from that. Similarly here also, as I said, the displacement also lowers, so this value keep going up with the lower draft. Now this residual resistance in the light load condition is given by this expression, the same way what we did before, the parameters are different. Here the S quantity is given by this expression, starting from C1 T1, C2 T2 and going up to C16 T16. So here this again, the C1 C2 are coming from the regression coefficients from the analysis, and T1 T2 etc. are given here, which are depending on the known parameters of the vessel, that is L, displacement, that is then B, T, LCB, same parameters what we have seen before. So all these parameters are known for the vessel, so you just substitute here, you get all T values. C1, C2 are the regression coefficient which is available in literature, so you can just find out what is this quantity. So that is the one. So once you get all these the CR values, then you can find out the residual resistance of the ship, that coefficient remains same for ship and model, and then you use ITTC formula to find out the frictional resistance. So ITTC formula, you know that. So CF is equal to 0.075 by log Rn minus 2 the whole square. So you know this formula. So if you use the parameter or Reynolds number of the model, you get the residual, the frictional resistance of the model, frictional resistance coefficient of the model, or if it's use the parameters of the or the Reynolds number of the ship, you get the frictional resistance coefficient of the so you can see that difference here. This is the one which makes the difference, which implies that Rn m is equal to Vm Lm by nu m, that is the Reynolds number of the model is equal to model speed into length of model divided by kinematic viscosity of water in the tank, usually fresh water, and rate of the ship is equal to Reynolds number of the ship is equal to Vs Ls by nu s. That is the velocity of ship or speed of the ship, this is the length of the ship, and nu s is the kinematic viscosity of sea water. So you can find out all this Reynolds number, go to ITTC formula, so you get ZFM or CFS, and from this you will get the CF value. So as we discussed, you have the total resistance or it says CTS is equal to CT CRS plus CFS plus allowances, maybe correlation allowance and other appendage allowance and all that, plus air resistance and everything come here. So you have the other components here. So here CRS is equal to same as CRM, which is coming from the BSRA expression what you have discussed here, and CF the frictional resistance component is coming from the ITTC formula. You have to choose the Reynolds number accordingly. So next type is so we have seen the BSRA now. So next type of vessel is called the Series 60 form. It's a very known, very popular form. A lot of research have been done on the particular type of vessel, Series 60, and which also got evolved during the 60s. And so the range of and the speed, the vessel ranges, it's very important that you have to have an idea about the validity range of application of these methods. So here you have Series 60. So here the validity range is Vk by Lf of the vessel should be between 0.2 and 0.9. That is the speed in knots divided by length in feet should be in this range. L by B should be in this range, B by T in this range. Cb is in this range, it is more full here, Lcb in this range. So you have a vessel which fall in this range, you can use this relation or this method. Here again CR residual resistance given by this expression over here, and this one is given by this expression here. So here you can see that all these coefficients are given in the literature, that is a regression coefficients, and x1, x2 and all these are given here, so same as we did in the BSRA thing, and the same author, he only did the regression for BSRA and also for Series 60. So here x1, x2, x3 and all these parameters are given here, and all the quantities which appear in these expressions are known, so easy to estimate these expressions, and then finally you substitute it back here, you get y, and this back to here you get CR. So that is the method used in Series 60 type of vessels. So here we move on to the next, it is relatively new, 1998, which is applicable for single screw and twin screw. So both type of vessels you can use this. So see the number of models they have done, 433 models, the tests have been done on that, and it has been done at Vienna ship model basin. So the length over surface, this is a parameter, LOS is used, and it is defined, it's there defined below, LOS for design draft, LWL is used for LOS, for ballast draft, the length of water line and the ballast condition is used. So the LOS depends on LWL, is LWL if it's at the design full load condition, or in the ballast condition LOS is the water line which you have to measure for the ballast condition. So that is a difference. The Froude number used in the formula, you based on length, is the length LFN is the Froude number, that is length based Froude number. So LFN, that the length, what length is used for the definition, you know, the Froude number is defined as V by rho G L, and that L which you have to use is defined by this. So LFN is equal to LOS if this ratio is less than 1. You have already know LOS here divided by length of the ship. So if this is less than 1, use this expression. If it's between 1 and 1.1, use this expression for the length which you use in the Froude number, or you use this if for this one less than or equal to this quantity. So that is what is the definition of LFN. So here what you consider is residual resistance coefficient CR is given by this expression, CR standard into CR for there is another parameter here, KL T by B raised to A1, B by L raised to A2. So you can find out the ratios here. All this TA is the draft at aft perpendicular, TF is a draft at forward perpendicular. If there is a trim it will be different, so that is why it is given here. Then LDP, DP is shown here is the propeller diameter, then N this is the number of rudder, then this is the now I think number of brackets, that is a propeller brackets, then the propeller bows, number of bosings for the propeller, and this is the number of thrusters, side thrusters used. So you know all these parameters from the vessel, you know what is the draft aft forward, what is the length, what is the breadth, then what is the breadth, I mean load water line length, then all this, you know, number of rudder, bracket, bows and everything. So you have all this information for the vessel. So then you, what you need to know is A1, A2, A3, all these quantities, which obviously you have to, it must be given here, you just see that, okay. And here you have the KL, KL is given by E1 into L power E2, you just see how we get this. So these are the values obtained. Then CR standard, that is a residual resistance for the standard model of standard vessel, is given by this expression, B11 plus B12 into Froude number plus B13 into Froude number square plus CB into this quantity. So over here there the Froude number here, then CB square, again the same expression here we can say. So here this is the expression for the residual resistance coefficient. Then you are looking to this one, CR FR, that is the maximum of 1 by FR by FR, this quantity, this is, this quantity is given by the, this expression, this expression which gives that. So you find out this ratio of Froude number, you know, from this you get FR KRIT, so you get the ratio and then raised to C1. So you take 1 and this value, maximum of you take assigned for this quantity. So once you get this, then all these coefficients B1, B112, A1, everything is given in the literature which comes out of the regression analysis of the data. So once you get all these coefficients, you just substitute it here, including E1, E2, everything is coming from there. So then you get, you can find out CR standard and then put it here, this is already estimate, all the quantities are known, to find out the residual resistance CR. Then use, as I explained, IDTC formula for CF. So once you get CR and CF, then you can find out the CT of the ship, and then you can find out the total resistance of the ship. So these are the total you know, different methods normally used for conventional vessels. We'll see in the next class about more details about the you know, advanced marine vehicle, how the resistance are estimated. So the methods what you have seen, the residual resistance, mainly depending on residual resistance or estimations, different methods we have seen, naming it Holtrop-Mennen, Van Utmarsen method, Guldama-Howald method, Savitsky's method, that's a Mercier-Savitsky method. Then we have seen the Gertler method, then other methods, you know, VSRA method, CD60 method, then the last one, Holdback, I think. So all these different methods are there. So a designer has to choose the method required for the resistance estimations appropriately. So he has to understand what is the vessel data, what type of vessel he is designing, and once you know the type of vessel and see what is the parameters, like what is L by B ratio, what is L by delta power to 1/3, and what is the B by T, what is the LCB position, what is the CB range. So all these parameters you have to look, what is the Froude number, all these matters. So considering this, look to the these different methods, you identify which method is more appropriate for the vessel under consideration and choose the method, estimate the resistance. So one thing you have to keep in mind is that these methods are used, or the resistance value which you estimate using these methods are only for the preliminary design of the vessel, which give information about the power requirement. Once you get the total resistance of the vessel, then you can roughly arrive at the power requirement of the required for the engine. So what you have to do is, you have to you get RT of the ship from any of these methods. So once you get RT into the speed of the ship, that gives the effective power of the ship. So the effective power of the ship is given by this. Then you know, you have to find out what is the effective power. Then you have to find out what is the assume propulsive efficiency eta d. Eta d normally you assume maybe approximately 0.6, 60%, just a guess, reasonable guess, eta d. So once you that eta d is equal to the effective power by delivered power, that is the effective power is given by this relation. PD is the power delivered at the end of the propeller. So if you have a propeller, you have the shaft going, and then it's going through a gear box and then finally to the engine. Okay, this is a gear, engine, then you have the shaft, propeller, then you may have some support bearings and all that for the shaft. Okay, so once you know this, this PD is the power required at this propeller, at this point there is a power required at that point, PD. So from the engine you get power, it's coming here, and this is the power at this point you have, this is called the shaft power, shaft available, the power available at the shaft end. So from the engine you get the power, then this is a shaft power, gear, you have losses in the gear, bearings and all that, and finally there is a power delivered at that. So this ratio between effective power and delivered power is the called eta d, that is the called, also called QPC, this is a Cauchy propulsive coefficient. So the transmission loss is usually 5% taken with the gear. So you have an idea what is PD, so you know PE value, so you know PD, so from that you can find out PD is equal to PE divided by eta d from here, and then you have the transmission loss, so into eta t, that's a power coming at this. Then if you are giving a derating of for the engine, usually 15% given, 0.85. So this, sorry, this gives a PB, engine power. Engine power is equal to PE by eta, this is PD, divided by transmission efficiency and divided by derating. So from which you will get what is the brake power required for the engine. So that is the advantage. So when the initials, at the initial stages of the design of the vessel, you would like to have a rough estimate of the engine power and also once you get the engine power, then you will be in a position to take an engine or you know select an engine from the catalog of the marine engine manufacturers. So there are different manufacturers, so you choose that. Various other parameters also come into picture. This gives an information, and this gives an engine power, which will go as a further input into the design finalization, further improvement in the design of the ship. So this method, what you have discussed, is they are good, maybe at that stage, but at later stage, it is advisable to have a maybe a model test and make sure that it's matching the requirement, and then you may have to relook into the engine which you selected, and finally make the propeller design and you know finalization of that. Okay, with that we conclude this class. Thank you.